taking you. You are my way, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Waves of mercy, waves of grace. Everywhere I look, I see your face. Your love has captured me. Oh my God, this love, how can it be? Every move I make in you. You make me move, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Every step I take in you. You are my way, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Waves of mercy, waves of grace. Everywhere I look, I see your face. Your love has captured me. Oh my God, this love, how can it be? Waves of mercy, so wonderful is your unfailing love. Your cross has spoken mercy over me. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart could fully know how glorious, how beautiful you are. Beautiful one. Captured my heart with this love. There's nothing on earth as beautiful as you. Beautiful one I love. Beautiful one I adore. Beautiful one my soul must sing. Beautiful one I love. Beautiful one I adore.
Nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. Amen. Have a seat. We're going to have a quick, short video introduction for VBS that's coming up.
grew up in a large family, and I was kind of the runt of the first of the four boys. Nobody in our family went to church. I always felt like I was kind of the outcast. Nobody wanted me around. I used to go to this candy store, and there was a lady there named Miss Taylor. She said, "Do you think that your parents would mind if my pastor made a visit?" And then somehow I got invited to Sunday school, met a teacher, a young man that was just, again, very warm and friendly. His name was Mr. Rice. He would come by the house and pick me up, and we would walk to church together. I needed some people just to love me for where I was and to show me that God could love me. I know that there are men and women who say, "Well, you know, I don't know if I can do it, or I'm busy." There are kids out there that you can touch. It's loving a child. It's letting a child see Jesus in you. You can do it.
Good morning, and welcome to Crossroads Church. It is wonderful to see all of you here this morning. It is so exciting. I know that it may be a little warm outside, but it is cool in here. I mean, I remember when it was hot in the furnace, they tell us in the Bible, but God made everything just right and just cool for us. I'd like to say a special welcome to all of our first-time guests and visitors, and invite everyone to join us for a little time after church in the lobby so we can get to know you a little bit better, know how we can be in prayer for you. And we'd also, for our first-time guests and visitors, we'd like to give you a loaf of Great Harvest bread. Here at Crossroads Church, we nourish the soul, the mind, and the body. We're going to take just a moment now to recognize we have some new members joining our church this morning. So I'm going to ask all of our new members to come on up. This is a group of people that's undergone, we're going to actually have you stand up on the platform for the service, but undergone about a 10-week class to get to learn more about our core values and more about our mission statement and our vision statement. And it's not just a one-night come and learn a little bit, but it's truly about a commitment. And so we have a little video clip we're going to show you that introduces our new members and some of what is important to them.
Hello, my name is Rob Dushek.
Hi, my name is Carol Blummel Johnson.
Hi, I'm Antoinette Benning.
And I'm Corey Benning. And we have two sons, Cedar and Ansel, who are 4 and 1 years old.
Sandy Johnson.
I'm Nicole Stachowiak.
I'm Rachel Warner.
I'm Chad Warner.
We have a 4.5-year-old Ethan and a 2.5-year-old Sydney.
Hi, we are Ryan and Candace Warner.
I was invited to go to Crossroads by a flyer in September of 2005. And started coming, and my son actually is the one that fell in love with the Wednesday night classes, and we started coming full time.
I've been coming to Crossroads probably on and off about a year and a half or so, shortly after they moved into the building.
We started coming to Crossroads just about 2 years ago, it must have been, right after you moved into the new building, I think. And
been with Crossroads for about 2 years now.
I have been coming to Crossroads for about a year and a half,
and we've been coming to Crossroads since February.
We started coming here in a little, late 2004, just before they had moved into the new building. So we found the church just by driving around. You'd see the sign up on the corner here and at the corner down by the school, so we popped in the door that way.
Probably acceptance. I would say that is because when I came to Crossroads, I was very accepted. And
I think it's excellence, just because it helps a person strive to be the best that they can be.
My favorite core value is compassion. I think it's something everyone needs.
Acceptance, I think, is probably the most important.
Compassion is my favorite core value.
My favorite core value is acceptance.
The acceptance.
My favorite core value is also acceptance.
My favorite core value is authenticity.
Yeah, mine would be the acceptance.
guess the genuine attitude of everybody is the best thing that I like about Crossroads. Something that I haven't felt at a church in a long time.
I like the music. I think that's very uplifting.
The warm welcome feeling that you get every Sunday morning when you walk in the doors. There's always
the children's programs and
just so many activities that you can get involved in.
And the openness and the welcoming attitude everyone has, and it feels like family. It feels like coming home.
It was very accepting, and it made us want to come back.
I really have liked the fact that it very much encouraged that you get involved and be an active member of the church.
Rather than them looking at you and saying, you know, you're not quite the talent we want you to have to do in this part, they say, what talents do you have and how can we use them?
When you join the church, we call it team membership, T-E-A-M, which stands for time, evangelism, abilities, and monies, that they are committing to sharing those things. It's not when you become a member that you get some great privilege or anything like that. It's you're making a deeper commitment to God and to the church. And so I ask the group at this time, do you promise to spend time with God on a regular basis? Do you promise to share the gospel message of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior with others, so that they may receive the gift of eternal life? Do you promise to serve the church using your God-given abilities and spiritual gifts? Do you promise to use your money in a way that glorifies God? I'm going to ask our new members in our congregation to join us in the Apostles' Creed as a response, which we'll put up on the PowerPoints here. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and he seated at the right hand of God the Father. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Jill Gibbs has been the leader for this group for the past many weeks, and as she's handing out the certificates to the members, I should also let you know that we have a new member class starting up. Maybe I should say another new member class starting up, and that's on Wednesday nights at 6:30, and Jill will be leading that, and anybody is welcome to come and join us for that. I know we still have plenty of spots available. There's always room for one more. Please help me in welcoming our newest members. At this point, I'd like to invite everybody to stand up and meet and greet those worshiping around you.
You seated high above, you are the one. one we love. This is a song of praise to you. King forever, you are the first and you're the last. You are sovereign, all your commands will always come to pass to give you glory. Oh, our Lord and King, our praise to you we bring. There is no other rock but you. You are the one we love. This is a song of praise to you.
Who is like you?
Who is like you? Who else is worthy of our praise? We exalt you. You reign in majesty and awesome splendor. King forever. Oh, our Lord and King. Our praise to you we bring. There is no other rock but you. Seated high above, you are the one we love. This is a song of praise to you.
Sing out, Father.
Abba, Father, your steadfast love will never fail. You are faithful. You are God, and I will worship in your courts forever. Oh, our Lord and King, our praise to you we bring. There is no other rock but you. Seated high above, you are the one we love. This is a song of praise to you.
Sing, oh, our Lord and
oh, our Lord and King. Our praise to you we bring. There is no other rock but you.
Seated high, Lord.
Seated high above. You are the one we love. This is a song of praise to you.
This is our song, Lord.
This is a song of praise to you.
We sing our song, Lord.
This is a song of praise to you.
Up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he. Together we
Almighty.
great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart.
So remember
your people. Remember your children. Remember your promise, oh God. Your grace is enough. Your grace. You use the weak to lead the strong.
You lead
us in the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along.
So remember
your people.
To yours, O Lord.
faithfulness, faithfulness, what you want from me.
Hallelujah. Isn't you glad that you're in the house of the Lord today? How beautiful it is to come and gather and learn and listen what the Word has to say today. Yes, Lord, take my mind, take my heart, and transform it. Holy is the Lord, and the earth is filled with His glory. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let us bow our head and pray. Father God, we know that we go through struggles. We know that we have hardships. We know that we go through problems. But we know that you are better than that. All we got to do is just give it up to you. Father God, during the course of this day, we ask of you to help see us through all these things that we go through here on this earth. We know that all we got to do is just give it up to you, and you will see us through it. You will release these things that we fight with about the enemy. We know that the enemy is not winning because we have you. We stand on your side, and we give you the glory, because there is no one else like you in all the earth, in all the heavens, in all the seas, in all the underworld. Because we know that you created this world, and you created everything for your glory. This is why we give you the glory, because you know how to handle it. Father God, we thank you for this glorious and beautiful day. This is the day that you have made. Allow us to rejoice in it and be glad in it. because we know, Father God, that you strengthen us in everything that we do, and it's all because of you. And we give you the glory, and we honor you, and we thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ, in the name of the Holy Spirit, amen. Let everybody say amen. All right, then.
Scripture this morning is from Luke 9, 23 and 24. Then he said to them all, if anyone will come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. So touch my spirit. I hope you all are blessed by these words.
About New Age spirituality. And we're at the Temple of Ek, which is a place where Ekankar, one of the New Age spiritual traditions, has begun to have its own place of worship. They actually only have worship services here once a month on Sundays at 10 a.m. But they're open throughout the week for tours, for times of meditation, for instruction. And they're one of the many that believe in a number of philosophies of really what they call New Age, which I call Old Age. It's pantheism, panentheism, a blend of kind of guru magic and mysticism combined with modern day rituals. And as we look at these various New Age spiritualities, Ekankar is one here located in Chanhassen, Minnesota. It's a nationwide where people come throughout the nation to the temple here and worship at the Temple of Ek. And it's one of many that you'll see movie stars or famous people come to. As you look at the temple in the distance here, you'll be able to see they have this massive building, larger than most cathedrals, and they spent over $10 million building this building for the Temple of Ek and to have the services there. And so we think of these as just small, little, crazy people that are in these cults. But they're very wealthy people, very powerful people that have bought into these very strange and cultic practices. Today we're going to be talking about New Age spirituality and everything from Baha'i to Kabbalah. There's a wide variety. We just visited the Temple of Ek, which stands for Ekankar. And they all have similar traditions. It's a kind of a blended pantheism. According to Russell Chandler, New Age is not a cult or a sect per se, but rather a hybrid mix of spiritual, social, and political forces, and it encompasses sociology, theology, and the physical sciences, medicine, anthropology, history, and the human potential movement, sports, and science fiction. You get it? It mixes everything together and says that it's this kind of mix of philosophy. It kind of incorporates almost all of human life. There's as many as 12 million active participants in what they would say, when they check off a box in the U.S. Census, they say, I am New Age. Again, there's between 9 and 10 million persons that will check the word United Methodist, and 12 million will say New Age. There's another 30 million that would claim that they're avidly interested. In other words, they participate in bits and pieces. They may be into things like channeling, or they may be into things like crystals, or they think that they believe in kind of some form of Native American spirituality. But basically they're saying, I'm open to new understandings of New Age movements. There's more than 3,000 publishers that offer New Age and occult books. Think about that. That just the publishers alone each do at least one book per year. That's over 3,000 new texts about New Age religions. And the best-selling New Age books include A Course in Miracles, A Return to Love, Out on a Limb, and The Celestine Prophecy. There are many, many more. One of the things we have to keep in mind about the New Age philosophy is that there's so many ways we encounter it, we don't even think about it. You may be taking a yoga class and not realize that they're talking about inner chi and energy. And instead of being a Christian yoga like offered here at Crossroads, it's something that draws you closer to this Eastern mysticism rather than to God. Or maybe a Taekwondo class or a martial arts class. Or maybe you're going to get a massage therapy or to do some type of chiropractic care. And instead of doing medical treatment, they get into this whole thing about energies and flow, and they start moving you to putting crystals on your back and saying that this will fix you. Again, those are ways that they are beginning to move from medicine into philosophy, into religion. I don't want to preach the sermon for our wonderful speaker here today, but I want to give you a taste that New Age spirituality is indeed serious, and it's all around us, particularly in America, from our TVs to our movies, and we need to take seriously not to give into this synchronistic understanding of religion. If you feel comfortable, put your hands up today. We're going to preach for Ryan, we're going to pray for Ryan, as he preaches God's word today. Heavenly Father, we ask that you be with Ryan Terpening this day, as he preaches from your word, as he reminds us of how tragic it is when we go down this New Age path, how it is that we need to put up our guard and to see the signs of how we can easily be ensnared by the evil one whenever we begin to mix kind of this religion of New Age into our life. Lord, I pray for Ryan this day that he's anointed with your Holy Spirit and that he shares from God's word through truth to speak to our hearts this day. We ask this in your holy name of your precious Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
I've never really liked religion that much, especially Christianity. When I think back about religion, Christianity, and Christians, I'm reminded of all the hypocrites. You know, the people who go to church on Sunday to worship their God, renounce evil, and claim back the souls stolen by Satan, all in the name of the Lord. Only the next 6 days, when I saw them, they would be saturated and soiled in sin. Sunday Christians, I called them. I think back to the misleading evangelistic tricks that Christians were notorious for. On Halloween one year, my friends and I went to this haunted house. It was done extremely well. It was phenomenal, except the end. When we stepped outside, we were swarmed and attacked by this mob of people asking us to fill out their survey. And that was fine. But at the end of the survey was a question when they asked us if we wanted to live in the hell that we just saw or accept Jesus as our Savior. I was less than impressed with their conniving trickery. I think back to the pushy, bigoted, closed-minded Christians who pushed a God on me that didn't make sense. They were quick to tell you that the only way to live is a life filled with Christ. But a life like mine, a life filled with sin, was sure to end in doom. I was raised in a Christian home, and so I knew some basics about this Christian religion. I knew there was a God in heaven, and I knew there was this Messiah named Jesus who went around preaching, and he preached about love. I also knew Christians were supposed to act like this man Jesus. But I never saw them act like him or love like him. Religion was not for me because I was my own man. I didn't need someone telling me how to live the right way. I was doing just fine the way I was. There was a line in the movie The Matrix that I kind of adopted as my philosophy for life. And it goes, I don't believe in fate because I like to think I'm in control of my own destiny. I'll live my life and you live yours. You believe what you want to believe and I'll believe what's right for me. That's that. Leave me alone. Besides, who did these Christians think they were? They believed one way and acted completely differently than what their religion said. It's like, they wanted to believe in God, but then be their own God. They wanted to pronounce their faith so much, yet they never did. They simply lived the way that they wanted to. I didn't see any changes in the way they acted or loved. I didn't see any changes in Christians from the other world. I never saw the point in believing. The problem is, though, God doesn't put up with that. And God doesn't work that way. You see, there are certain guiding principles in each of our lives that say differently. A professor of mine once said it this way. He said, the things that are most personal tend to be most universal. You see, we have these innate desires that come not from ourselves, but from a higher source. We all long to be loved. It's a personal issue. It's a universal issue. We all long for respect, and we all long for acceptance, and we all long to worship something more than ourselves. The problem is, if you're anything like me, it's easy to get caught up living for yourself. I believe it's this, and I'm quoting from a book, this inward navel gazing, where we develop cults and life philosophies that detour and detract people from Christianity. Scriptures like the one we read today are so contra-culture. Jesus says in Luke that we must deny ourselves, take up our cross daily, and follow him. Because if we try to save our lives, we will lose them. But if we lose our life to Jesus, he will save us. This passing of power isn't always a popular thing. I mean, think back to your personal life. It's so difficult to give up the power. It's not a popular thing, especially among the cults, and especially among New Age spirituality. New Age spirituality, what is it? I'm not even sure I know, and after researching it, I'm not sure anyone else knows exactly what it is either. One thing that I do know is that there's no self-denial, there's no cross-bearing, and there's no following Jesus. You see, there's no self-denial because there's absolutely no need for self-denial within the New Age spirituality movement. Because New Age is, well, it's what you want. It's what you make of it. See, world, New Age is this syncretic religion. And in the book World Religions and Cults, it says that New Age, there's no definitive statement of New Age beliefs. There's no founder, no central church or headquarters, and no formal structure. They have no central authority and no set beliefs. What you want to believe, you believe, and that's fine. There are, however, some characteristics that define New Age, but once again, since you make it what you want it to be, these characteristics won't necessarily fit in with everybody's New Age philosophy for their life. I mentioned already that one of the characteristics is religious syncretism. It's a hybrid religion. It's not even really a religion, it's a philosophy for living your life. And with that religious syncretism, you take and you steal and you borrow other ideas from other mainstream religions to develop this movement that you have, the spirituality for your life. Another one is monism. Monism is a different idea, but you have to kind of wrap your mind around a little bit. It's that all is one. That, I'll try and describe it for us a little here. All of us are connected in some way. It's just we don't entirely realize we're connected right now. But what's going to happen is that we're going to have this grand consciousness of life. That sooner or later, we're all going to wake up and we're going to realize that we're all connected. And when that happens, we'll be able to know what each other's thinking. We'll be able to feel how other people are feeling. And we will be one with this universe, one with this world, and one with each other. It's kind of off the wall. They also have pantheism within the New Age movement. And pantheism, it's actually quite similar to Christianity in what we believe. See, we believe that God is everywhere and that God's in everything. But with pantheism, they believe that God is in everything and God is everything. And since God is everything, we should worship God because God deserves worship. And so we worship chairs and we worship trees and we worship rivers and we worship rocks. We worship nature because nature is God, because God is in nature. Unlike Christianity, where we say God is in it, but we only worship God and not a tree. Along with their pantheistic beliefs, they believe in deification of humanity. Whereas if God is in everything, if God is everything, then God is within each of us, and God is us. So we are God. Each one of us are unique, individual gods. It's a little different than the scripture we read today where Christ says we must deny ourselves. And I think about, why does he say we have to deny ourselves? And if you think about it, he says to deny ourselves because self-denial shows your commitment to something. Now, you can't be on a diet, you can't go into your favorite restaurant and order the dessert menu, because that means you're not committed to a diet. But if you're committed to a diet, you don't indulge in that dessert. So within New Age, there's no self-denial because you take a little bit of this, you take a little bit of that. It's a buffet religion, and it is all you can eat. If you can get it on your plate, you can eat it, you can worship it, you can develop it as your life philosophy. It's whatever you want. It's very individualistic, like I said before, inward navel-gazing religion. But Dr. Hazen, out of the book World Religions and Cults, I'm quoting from him, he says, "Traditional religions certainly have an inward dimension to them, but they almost all start with looking outside of oneself for revelation from above, or to nature, or to wise teachers for spiritual enlightenment." And that's the appealing thing about New Age, is that it's what you want. And we live in a consumeristic culture where if you want it, you go buy it. If you need it, you go buy it. If you don't need it, you go buy it. It's just more, more, more. Add to it, add to it, add to it. And so that's why New Age is appealing to over 42 million people, 12 million members, or 12 million people who associate themselves with it. It's what you want. There's no boundaries. And isn't that what we like? No boundaries? With no self-denial and no cross-bearing. There is no price to pay in New Age. You see, Christ says you must bear your cross. There's a price take for following Jesus. This is not a free thing. You have taken your life and you've committed it to Christ. It's no longer yours, it's his. He's going to change you, he's going to do what you want with it. But along the way, there's some things you need to do. You need to deny yourself, he says. You need to take up your cross. Now, don't mistake taking up your cross as a burden, because it's different than a burden. It's your average daily load. It's what you need to deal with. Paul talks about this in Galatians 6:2, where he says that carry each other's burdens. But here Christ is telling us to carry our own cross. Carry your own load. But when it comes to burdens, carry them for each other. We are the body of Christ. We are a family. We are to bear each other's burdens. We're supposed to help each other out. We're supposed to support each other. So get on it, Christian, and support each other. But you know what? Within each of us, we have our own load to carry. Christianity is not burdensome. In fact, if you look at the different religions, it's the most freeing religion we have. Because in cults, you have this authoritative figure that tells you what to do. You need to follow him or her, and that's the only way you're going to become saved. That's the only way. Even if what that person says contradicts what they're going to say next week, you have to follow it because they say so. Not so with Christianity. God says, if there's something that you don't think is right, you take everything that you've heard and you bounce it off the Bible. He says, go ahead and test me. He says, I'll prove myself right. You can test God in Christianity. You can test your faith, and it will back itself up. It is not a burden. Christianity, therefore, it's not a self-improvement course either. Like some of these religions, like New Age, everything is about you. It's that inward navel-gazing where It's all about me, 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 and not about you. Christ says, though, serve one another. Go out and serve the world. This is not a self-improvement course. It is a God improvement. God will improve you because it's no longer your life. You've given it to God. It's kind of a tough concept to wrap around if you do believe in this New Age spirituality, because within that, there is no central God. I mean, you are a God, but I know that you don't rule this universe. So there is no central God. And in Christianity, you're not your own God. You follow Jesus. There's a reason for this. It's because if you think back to the Garden of Eden, when people were created, you have to think about why people were created. What is our sole purpose here for? We were created for relationship. And you think back to Adam and Eve and how they would walk in the garden talking to God. They'd walk by Him and they communicated with Him freely. But then sin crept into this world and completely destroyed that. And so now there's this great chasm between God and Adam and Eve, and they can't get back to where they need to be because sin has broken that relationship. And since we are people developed for relationship, we need something to get us back there. So that's why Jesus comes, dies for our sins, bridges that gap, and now we can be in that perfect relationship with God again. But in New Age, you do not need salvation because you're your own God. You save yourself. But Christ says in our verse that if you want to save your life, you will lose it. But if you lose your life to Christ, He will save it. It's quite different and quite opposite than what New Age teaches with affirming oneself and glorifying themselves. New Age follows nobody but themselves. They're an individualistic cult or religion or life philosophy or whatever you want to call it or whatever you want to make of it, because it's that easy. You can do whatever you want because that's New Age. Now, I said some bad things about it. Well, not bad, but I really like people. I really do. I mean, when it comes to evangelism, think about how easy it would be to evangelize to them. I mean, they're already spiritual people, and if you've tried to evangelize to anybody, you know that one of the toughest things to do is to convince people that there's a spiritual realm that we live in, that there is a spiritual world. And a lot of people just can't wrap their hands around that. Because you can't see it, you can't feel it, you can't taste it, you can't touch it. But there is a spiritual world. Now, they're completely engrossed in this spiritual world. So half the battle is done for you already. The only problem is they're misled. In John 8, 3-2, Christ says, "The truth will set you free." It's our job to plant that seed of truth in them. Now, what good would we be if, you know, once we came saved, we were taken up to heaven and our job was done? That's not the way God works. What He does is He says, "You have become saved. Now you start your life living for Me, and here's what I want you to do. You have all this stuff I need you to do. You're going to work for Me." And He says, "So I want you to take that seed of truth, and I want you to plant it in them. I'm going to take you, and I'm going to use you like a mirror. I'm going to reflect Christ's love through you. I'm going to use you as conduit to get the truth out to My people. You are here for a reason, not to sit here and listen to some guy talk. You are to plant the truth in people." Christians, there are 42 plus million people extremely interested in this New Age movement. 42 million people. Where's your part in this whole grand scheme of things? What will you do to plant that seed in one of those people and let it grow into a big, beautiful flower? Let's pray. Christ, we come to You not claiming much for ourselves, but claiming that You are indeed the authoritative figure in our life. Be with us, Lord, as we go out in that world and as we go evangelize, not just to the 42 million people interested in New Age, but to all the other religions too that need you, that are searching for you. They have those personal desires, the same as us, for love, acceptance, salvation. Use us as you will. Help us to be tools to build your kingdom. We thank you for your presence here today. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen.
Throughout our lives as Christians, we have a number of things that we do, whether you look at them as rituals or different things that we do to worship Christ and to remember the sacrifice that God did make for us. One of those things that we do is we celebrate the Last Supper that Jesus had before he was betrayed. On the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, and he broke it and said, "This is my body, broken for you, for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you eat of this, do so in remembrance of me." In like manner, after the meal, he took the cup, said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of this, do so in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts of Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for our sins. And so we proclaim the mystery of faith. Please repeat after me. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, Almighty God, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be in the world, the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. And so, with the confidence of the children of God, we pray as you taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The table is set. Anybody and everybody is welcome to come and partake of communion. You do not need to be a member of this church or of any other church. The ushers will not be dismissing you. We just ask that you come as the Spirit leads you. We're going to ask that you come down this side or that side aisle and have it at one of these three stations, and then return back by the back side or even this front aisle right here. Come as the Spirit leads you.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of my love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee. Take my sin.
In just a few moments, we'll be taking our morning offering. If you are a guest or a visitor, please do not feel obligated to give. This is a time when we choose to take just a few moments to give back a portion of what God has blessed us with. Also, you'll notice in the bottom corner of your bulletin, that little spot there, you hear the ripping sound. Go ahead and rip it out there so we can know who's worshiping with us and how we can be praying for you and supporting you. So we ask that you rip that out and fill that out. Go ahead and stick that in the offering plate when that comes around. While we're taking our offering, we'll also have prayer partners on both sides this morning. So if you have anything you'd like to come up and pray about, the altar is open to you to come up and pray. Pray with somebody. At this moment, we'll receive our offering.
The world is closing in on the inside, but I'm not showing it. And all I am is crying out. I hold it in, fake a smile, and I'm broken. I'm broken. The only one can understand, and only one can hold the hand of the broken. When no one else knows how I feel, your love for me is proven real. When no one else cares where I've been, you run to me with outstretched hands, and you hold me in your arms. Flying, Lord, I am flying.
Please stand, if you would, for our closing blessing and our final song this morning. As you go on your way, know that God will go with you. God will go before you to show you the way, and God will go beside you to befriend you. God will go behind you to encourage you, above you to watch over you, and within you to give you peace. Go in God's peace this day and always. Amen.
All I want to do, be close to you. And all I want to say, is thank you for the way. You love me, you love me.
Let me know.
You are faithful, all that you have promised and loving. And all of your ways, and still, all of my failings, you love me.
Thank you so much for joining us this morning. Please stick around for a time of fellowship. Parents, don't forget to pick up your kids. Have a blessed week.
You are faithful to all that you have promised and loving in all of your ways. And still, with all of my failings, you love me. You love me, you love me. Faithful, all that you have promised and loving in all your ways. And still, with all of my failings, you love me, you love me, you love me. La 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 la, la 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 la, la 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 la.
Thank you.